Now it is. The annual needs to be completed. It's all being done electronically now, so, but it needs to be completed by April 15th, or we'll visit you at maybe Sheridan Federal Prison or something. We'll visit. Okay. Approval of the minutes for the February 8th, 2017 meeting. Do I have a motion on the minutes or comments on the minutes?
Comment that I was listed as present and absent, and I was absent, so.
Oh, but the ones you have are, I corrected that.
Oh, okay, the latest version is correct.
Yeah, corrected, yes, yeah. You're everywhere, Jim.
Yes. I was in the audience, too.
Motion to approve.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear who moved and seconded. These two, you two?
Sure.
All in favor of approving the minutes of February 8th as written, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Two abstentions. It carries. The next area that we have on our agenda is appearance of interested citizens. This is a time made available for those who wish to speak about an issue that is not on the agenda tonight. And it looks like I have one person who would like to come up and talk. Shonda Jones?
Oh, no, never mind. I just signed in and didn't have anything to say.
Well.
That's simple.
Okay, well, we thank you for coming.
This is my first time here, can you tell?
Well, this is my first time doing a public hearing, so, okay. Moving on, item number four is a public hearing, and it's the text amendment section 2.10, commercial mixed use. I'm going to be opening that portion of the public hearing. Staff report.
Thank you, Chair Sangster. Tonight we have for the public hearing section 2.110, the commercial mixed use section. As you guys all are kind of aware of, the packet was thick this time around. So hopefully you had a chance to kind of get through that and absorb some of that. I'll try to give you the Cliff Notes version of the overall packet, and then you guys can ask me questions and whatnot, but I also know we do have some other testimony that's going to happen tonight, so fun times. So what happened with this one is on February 6th, the City Council actually initiated and signed a resolution directing staff to initiate the text amendment process. They were petitioned by letter by Safeway, specific Safeway's representation, to look at amending the CM zone where we have use restrictions specific to that Shemawa River Road area. That's kind of an overlay zone, but it's not exactly an overlay zone, but it's a restricted area, and there's a list of prohibited uses, one of which being a gasoline service station. And so Safeway's letter, which is included in the packet of part of the information submitted to council originally, basically came and requested that the city consider amending the code to allow for the establishment of a fueling station. So I know that normally staff reports are not 4 pages long, so I apologize, but it was difficult to put into a brief synopsis of all the kind of nuance that goes along with an amendment when we look at something like this. Clearly, we're not doing a site-specific detail review of a land use application because this is a text amendment, not a conditional use, not a subdivision, not a site plan review. So that's one thing that obviously right off the top we want to make sure that we point out. At the same time, we can't very well look at it as if we don't kind of know why and what this is going to or could result in. So we started looking at it as staff, and I specifically struggle with it. We actually had some meetings with the Safeway folks as well to kind of chat about the nuance of it and how we would move forward. And ultimately, we feel that their letter was actually very, very well stated in some of the reasons of why they were pursuing this process based on the grocery business, based on the uniqueness of their site, based on being able to address one of the biggest issues being, you know, traffic. And so we looked at it and said, well, okay, as we bring this before you, how do we look at this? And you guys will notice on your list of things, of work plan from a year ago, the Shemawa River Restriction Area has been on that work plan as something that we believe is something that needs to be reconsidered at some point in time. It hasn't made its way up to that priority level for a number of reasons. Primarily right now, the reason is the fact that we've been the recipients of two TGM grants, one for education and outreach to look at the cost of growth, and the second, looking at the revitalization area plans for kind of the three distinct areas in Kaiser, one of which is kind of centrally located around the Shemawa River area. So as we looked at it, we kind of saw four pathways forward for Planning Commission to consider. One was to basically make no change to the KDC, say this isn't the greatest of timing, we want to put the pause button on it, say no, we're going to hold until we get through these other processes and just let it be as it is and say what we've said for the past, and I think Hirsch, you were saying something, for the past 30 years, literally, as it's been talked about as fuel being an option there on that corner or a possibility. So that's option one. Staff's not recommending that's the option we take. Option two was to eliminate the Shemawa River Road Restriction Area completely. The position could be taken to say, hey, it served its purpose. It was there since 95 when it was originally established. Most of that area has been developed and redeveloped, and the ability to achieve a lot of development objectives may not be that practical. There's an argument to be had for that. We feel that that's short-sighted, especially in consideration of the fact that we're moving into kind of an exciting grant process to get some consultants to work on looking at possibilities to do some innovative stuff in that area and in other areas in town. So we feel that's too premature and frankly not appropriate at this time. And honestly, at this type of a hearing, you don't and can't engage the public at the level that you should to make those bigger sweeping policy changes, at least in my opinion. The third option would be to go with the text amendment that Safeway proposed in the original letter to council. We feel like it was a good base point for us to look at. However, we were uncomfortable with it. It was essentially to make it an outright permitted use. And that's fine, except there's no real ability to make sure that specialized concerns would be or could be mitigated. And so it kind of would just open up the playbook for just that one use. And then in my mind, it makes you have to kind of go dominoes and say, well, what about all the other listed uses in that area then? Why not all of those too? Why just this one? So what we are proposing is basically to look at allowing it specifically though as a conditional use. So it would require additional staff review, an additional land use process. It would provide a mechanism and a tool to essentially place conditions on the development to deal with the mitigating measures of the traffic, the site design, the aesthetics, all of those kind of concerns. That's a tool that we can use to help mitigate those. So ultimately, that's where we landed with. Safeway had submitted originally to council a traffic study that I think was from 2013. They got that updated, and I think the traffic, and you guys are going to talk about that a little bit, right? Give us some bullet points on it. So they did submit an updated study that actually spells out some specific requirements of this site. And while that's not 100% part of the text amendment, I think what it does do a good job of is basically spells out, well, in that conditional use process, that's really where those conditions and those mitigation measures would lie and be required in. But it does give us a good idea of, well, here's how we could deal with the traffic stacking out onto Shemawa or the traffic within the site. And they're looking at basically rebuilding the driveway intersections, widening the main one, changing and reconfiguring the parking lot area to prevent some of the issues you have there when you're pulling in off of Shemawa, which are things that, as a staff, we think are good. There's also included in the packet a kind of a brief, an analysis light of the traffic study by the city engineer's office, basically looking at the work done by the Kittleson group and saying, yeah, we concur, is essentially what that says in there. So with that, I think there's definitely a lot of room for questions. We did, looking at Safeway's letter, we felt it was compelling, the argument they placed in their initial request that this fuel station and the traffic study kind of speaks to it. There was a Safeway kind of specific traffic study done in 2001 that indicated, which it's cited in there, but it indicated, I think it's a 36% reduction of traffic volumes that are created at a gas station when it's in conjunction with a Safeway, because there's that kind of ability to share trips. Somebody goes to the grocery store and they get their gas while they're there. One of the things that we looked at is what we feel makes this unique versus all the other uses that could or could not be allowed off that prohibited list. Because there was talk, well, maybe all of them should be able to be done as conditional uses. We felt, though, that this kind of, it creates, yes, it's a text amendment, but it creates a finite application of this amendment. There's not a lot of spaces in the restriction overlay where it's possible to deal with this. And so we feel with these mitigation measures, it kind of represents a pretty good compromise on, instead of doing nothing, doing something that can allow a business to move forward with their kind of aspirations, and yet assuring that the city concerns and the neighbor concerns and the overall transportation concerns and all that can be addressed. And a big piece of it in our mind was the fact that it truly is it truly can be looked at as an accessory use. You know, the site's already developed with a Safeway, and if they were going to go in and put up a bank in the parking lot, another bank in the parking lot, they could do that. They could develop the site with another use that could be completely separate and would be its complete own generator of traffic. In this case, they're looking at developing a use that they feel, and looking at the stuff they've submitted, I think it's accurate. It is accessory to and functions as essentially an outdoor aisle of Safeway. It's just one you bring your car through. being a little bit facetious there, obviously, but no, I think it's a legitimate kind of way to look at it. But one thing that is unique, and I believe the folks will talk about it. You know, there was a lot of discussion and looking at, well, under what standards do we think this would be appropriate? And there's a lot of different things that can be discussed, but we did really feel that due to the accessory nature to that existing commercial development, we feel that it can be appropriate. I would not be near as comfortable if it were, hey, we're going to go and just plop down a brand new gas station within that restriction area overlay on a vacant parcel or a parcel that's been raised to make way for it. And so that's where we've proposed some text in there, limiting it to being only in conjunction with a retail food store of over 15,000 square feet. We're also limiting or proposing to limit the types of items sold at that gas station, so it doesn't become a true retail driver and attractor, but rather something that is subservient and accessory to. We also don't want it to be, and actually I thought Safeway's letter did a great job of this too, talked about describing it as opposed to a gasoline service station, and sorry, I'm going to paraphrase this because it's getting long, but they had talked in their letter about it being instead of a full-on gasoline service station where you're doing automotive repairs and things like that often happen, it really is a fueling center or a fueling station where you're doing, you know, fuel and gasoline-related products there. So that's basically what this text amendment represents in our mind. And with that, I would be happy to try to answer any questions.
Any questions from the commissioners on staff before I move to the list of people here that would like to talk?
I just had one quick question. In the first option for what the city could choose to do, it says staff feels that while taking no action is an option, it's not the most responsive approach. So is it not responsive to Safeway or not responsive to the citizens of Kaiser?
I think from, I don't have numbers for you, Michael. I will say this, over my almost 20 years of working here, I field a lot of questions on the desire for that from a citizen point, but yes, definitely not being responsive to Safeway and also to council who directed staff to initiate the process. So I think to do nothing, it doesn't, the responsiveness was kind of threefold there. Yeah, and I won't even argue about the citizens because I didn't poll them all, you know, not at all. Safeway's clearly got a request in. There's a resolution passed, so we're kind of being directed, bring some sort of a recommendation back, right? And that recommendation could totally be no. I mean, that's absolutely legitimate, but that's what I meant by that.
Okay.
And when we use that word responsive, what we're talking about is to not have the discussion at all would not be responsive to the situation at hand, the request of the business owner, as well as the discussion in the public arena, this public hearing and the public hearing that will follow. To simply say we're not going to do it is what we're talking about. We need to have the discussion, and the policy decision is the council's to make, and you are making a recommendation on this language that goes to council about the kinds of restrictions that we as staff feel would be appropriate to establish with excessive setbacks, that it doesn't have a street presence. It feels more in line with the original ordinance and the goals and objectives that were created with that ordinance. So that's why we have developed these sets of what we believe would be appropriate restrictions. But obviously this is the policy development process, and you are part of that process, and the council is making that policy decision.
Okay, we have a number of people that have signed up to talk tonight, and what we'll do, since there's a number of people, everybody will have a 5-minute limit. However, as chair, if we're into a subject matter that we want to hear a little more, I can extend the time. So the first person up is Jeff Cowan, Chief Cowan from the Kaiser Fire Department. Excuse me, Fire District. Sorry, Jeff.
Thank you, Commissioner, and checking in to see if my phone's not working out. I'm sure you enjoyed that noise. I'm going to move over a little bit. I'm probably not the first person to do that, am I?
No.
Hi there, Jeff Cowan, Kaiser Fire Chief. And we are located right across the street from Safeway, which is a common description of where's your fire station. As a fire chief here for Kaiser, on Friday begins my 10th year here with Kaiser. No one's more shocked about that than me. And St. Patrick's Day is a great commemorative. This is my 36th year of my career. So I'm here tonight because we have concerns about a proposed fueling station at the Kaiser Safeway, because we have concerns about the traffic, we have concerns about the entrance, the egress, all the things, and we're right across the street from the Safeway. It's important that we've not spent 10 minutes talking about this in an official capacity regarding a plan for this, for the gas station or each of those other things. We don't know what it looks like. We don't know what the proposal is, the staging, each of the other things. We only know what current conditions are going on right there. So I've no plan that we've been reviewed. But River Road traffic and the Shimawa intersection has really concerns about the traffic flow and the egress. It has concerns about its failings and everything else that is going on all the time. The memorial on the corner of Shimawa and River Road that we drive by every day is a bleak and grim reminder that all you have to do is step off a curb in that area and you could lose your life. With all of those other things going on, The Safeway entrance on Shamal Road is just as dangerous, because even one of our Kaiser police officers coming back to the station got bagged at that station, at that intersection right there, that simply a man turning left can't see as the person turning right and nailed one of our police officers on a motorcycle. I'm concerned about the Safeway, and this is right in front of our station. So all the other things that were going there, and then and it hasn't been a year since those things are occurring, and they're occurring on a regular basis. So you have traffic data that is in front of you that I believe is fairly accurate. So a proposed fueling station adding to that, I understand that 36% of the people that go to Safeway would then come back and they would use their time to buy gas while they're there, but what about the other 64% of the new traffic that is coming through there? So if you look at that, if you were there on Monday at 4:30, you see that the parking lot is full. It's at its maximum capacity without a gas station. So I'm dismayed how a proposal of this would work or fit. So when we were listening to the text amendment plan in each of those, the first item, number one, is that make no change. Absolutely support that. Don't change it. It's there for a reason. It was put there for a reason. We have not changed our reason. Now, I have a traffic analysis that was provided by Kittleson and Associates and Transportation Engineers, February 28, 2017. I imagine that's in the record for that, and I've evaluated that. The glaring omission of that traffic report, it's absolutely silent to the fire station across the street. It does what it was asked to do. It goes out to the perimeter, goes out to the sidewalks, but it doesn't go across the street. So I review the data, and the methodology of that is a 2000 base standard that goes through from a 10-year-old transportation plan from 2007. And table four on the item is on page 19 shows the entrances on River Road. They exceed critical crash safety right now before we do anything. So the peak traffic is even worse. So the safety percentile is greater than 95% to the entrances on 95.
We'll give you a few more minutes. Okay.
Thank you. And I will present this, and I'll wrap up shortly. The parking lot photos from the elevated positions are not realistic, and I think they're deceiving, because the parking lot size, depth, and occupancies of the vehicles is not illustrated there. It doesn't show real-time or peak-time views of what the parking lot looks like, but they're simply illustrations. So the Kaiser Fire District response data, that's really what we're talking about, what's going on here every day. The fire district responds out of the station 15 times a day. And when we're coming out of the station, the traffic backup mode that's in the right turn lane going west, the straight on lane going west down Shamal Road, and the left turn lane that's turning southbound onto River Road, those three lanes are full. Every day, every response. And we're coming into the oncoming traffic to go out onto River Road on a very difficult corner that's 15 times a day. And so when you're looking at the data that's going out there for 15 times going out, there's 15 times coming back where the units are waiting and the traffic back up. And the data that of the percentile, they're at the 95th percentile at that intersection now during peak traffic times. And so 15 times a day a vehicle is going out, 15 times a vehicle comes back. During peak traffic times, our fire apparatus are snagged up in traffic waiting for the next response to come back. Safeway itself generates 20 calls a year. Add the Sherry's there, it's 26 calls a year. So a couple of times a month, we're going to have emergency response vehicles coming into the parking lot there. And each of those, that's a regular thing that's going on right now. So in summary, we haven't spent 10 minutes talking about a proposal here. I know that we're talking about a text amendment. But based on the changes of the proposal was, you know, no change was item number one, or item number two was throw the change out and remove all restrictions, or let Safeway come back with a proposal, which was number three, or number four, try to mitigate these concerns. I understand the mitigate the concerns. That's not a bad idea. I'm at a dismay right now of how we would get to where they want to be based on the data that I have currently, and I think that would be very difficult to achieve. I think the right answer right now is say no to the text amendment change. But based on this, I've not seen a plan or proposal, and the discussion was brought to our attention by the activity of this group of the Planning Commission. I'm grateful for the attention. I have a copy of the traffic survey, and I have reviewed it. But our primary concern is emergency response and public safety. I'd be happy to answer any questions, and I apologize I wasn't able to do that in 5 minutes.
Any of the commissioners have questions for the chief?
Yeah. It's more of a comment. I just wanted to say that based on what you're saying, obviously there'll be more traffic going into the gas station to shop there. But it's, from what I've read in the traffic study and their mitigation plans, it sounds like they'll be inducing even more car travel in the area in general, which will probably tack on more vehicles. So.
Right. And I also believe it's flawed that it doesn't take emergency response into it as well, the fire station across the street. Thank you for your time today. I'm very grateful.
Thank you very much, Chief. The next person we have on the list to speak tonight to us is Adam Wittenberg.
Hello, everybody. Thank you, Chief, for your service.
You're welcome.
Okay. My name is Adam Wittenberg. My address is 5125 Wittenberg Lane, Kaiser, Oregon. Father of two kids. I actually grew up here in this city. Well, actually grew up here. I think I had second grade right here at Salem Private. I used to walk down the street to go home, down to off of Claggett. So, what we have is this overlay restriction, and the chief brought up very good concerns. I come from a business standpoint and a commerce standpoint, and in our estimation, how we view new companies coming into the city, it helps our citizens. We've had Hagen's left, Roth's left, and I personally am very enthused that Safeway is willing to invest more into our city. We need more quality companies to invest more in our cities. I also have a dog in the fight. We own the Wells Fargo building, and we just purchased the Bank of the Cascades building, and it falls under this overlay restriction. We would like quality companies to come back, and some of the companies aren't looking at us. Burgerville's not looking at us. Chick-fil-A is not looking at us. Del Taco is not looking at us. And other great companies, and I know I'm kind of putting myself in a box with just fast food, but it's not just that. We have two things that we're looking at. Either we can have great companies come back, or we have, I get three offers a week to sell it to a dispensary. Well, all of us know that we can't put a dispensary right there because it's too close to the school. Doesn't stop them. So in the next 20 years, all of our financial institutions are going to turn over. You've got prime locations on every one of those financial institutions, and we're going to be looking for new innovative companies that Salem doesn't have that would add value to our community. That's what we're looking at. And on the big picture, we're in 11 different states right now, and we're really excited about coming back to Kaiser and reinvesting into Kaiser. I got excited talking with Shane and with Nate, and with the special things they're doing in the next 2 years. It's just, it's exciting time. So when companies want to invest, we need to make sure that we're not prohibiting quality companies from further investing in our community to help in a need. And that's about it. I wanted to thank everybody for their process, for the process, and listening to us and your consideration of removing the overlay restriction. Do you have any questions of me?
Commissioner?
Question. Michael. So you obviously understand the business market on River Road to some extent.
Yeah.
So there's three gas stations within a mile of Safeway and one more that's not even another mile past. So would you say the market needs another gas station on River Road?
From my perspective, Safeway's is one of those great companies that's staying in our community when they could have left. I'm 100% with the chief on saying improvements need to be made to the ebb and the flow. With these gentlemen and how they can look at things, any improvement to the ingress and egress over by the, I believe it's Oregon State University Credit Union, that's just, it's so close up there. There's, you, the planners have a good handle on how they can get those flows, and if everything meets the criteria, I don't think you should prohibit it from business. One business has a chain reaction to another business. There's a very good reason why Burgerville's not in Salem anymore, or won't want to come to Salem, but was considering coming back to Kaiser. So we have to see that from our history and learn from it, and keep building on the things that help our citizens. I love this city. I love this community. This is, it's fantastic. We've got something great here, and I'd like to keep growing it for the businesses to prosper. Does that answer your question? Do I think that you need the
Is there a deficit in the market where that's not being served?
Yes. Your Lock Haven cutoff. People, when you come down Lock Haven from I-5, you don't go towards McNary. If you're not going towards McNary, you're going to be on the other side of the road to get gas, and usually you're going to go to another community because you're not going to go, it's kind of funny, but you're not going to go to the one on, what is it, the Astro? You're not going to go to the Astro on the right-hand side. You're going to wait till you get all the way down to the 76, and by then you've already lost what you're going down to that side. If you had one on the left-hand side, I think it would help the community, especially with as many houses and roofs that you have around it.
Anything? Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate it.
Thanks for being a long-term resident.
Absolutely.
There's few of us.
Absolutely.
The next person we have is Chris Bremer.
Actually, Mr. Chairman, I'm not Chris Bremer, but I'm we have several of us with the same team, and the thought was that maybe that I would lead off. I'm a little later down on the list. I'm Seth King.
Okay.
Do you mind if I go ahead and present?
That's fine, as long as our secretary recorder gets that.
Okay. Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the Planning Commission. My name is Seth King. I'm a land use attorney at Perkins Coie, which is located at 1120 Northwest Cooch Street, 10th floor in Portland, 97209. I'm here tonight on behalf of Albertson's Safeway, which, as you heard from Mr. Witham, was the original party requesting the text amendment, and of course is also the owner and operator of the grocery store at the corner of Shemawa and River Road. Want to talk about a couple of items tonight. First is just the general need here that we see being served by this amendment. And that is that we do believe, as explained in our letter to the city, that there's a need for an opportunity for fuel stations in conjunction with grocery stores. And as we've discussed there in the letter, by allowing these fuel stations in conjunction with grocery stores, it will allow for an efficient utilization of land, allows people to take care of two things in one trip on one property. We think there's also a general public need for the city to allow existing businesses to maintain themselves, to expand and grow in their existing locations rather than having to relocate. And we do think that the proposal is not inconsistent with the city's intent here of original intent of restricting full service gas stations, because this would be a more limited fuel center that wouldn't have the full auto body repair and related aspects. The in terms of our specific position, as you heard, we did have an original proposed text amendment, and staff has now come forward with an alternative We are prepared to support the staff alternative with the exception of, on all counts with the exception of one. And that is item one, standard one, under the proposed text amendment, which would prohibit sales of other merchandise at the fuel center. And on this point, our preliminary review is that this is not a workable business model. We don't have intentions of developing like a full service convenience store or anything in conjunction with the fuel center. But we our experience has been that some ancillary sales in conjunction with the fuel are expected by customers and are a necessary part of the business model. What we would request is that you, if you do move forward with a recommendation to approve the text amendment, that you do so only after deleting that prohibition on sales of other merchandise, or we'd request in the alternative that you continue the matter for a month to allow us time to do some research and analysis, to meet with staff, and to propose an appropriate limitation on sales that wouldn't be an outright prohibition, but would be something less than just carte blanche. Unfortunately, we're not prepared to propose that alternative tonight. We've only known for a couple of days that this particular standard was going to be there. And again, we just would like to take the time to make a thoughtful approach and on that point.
More time. I want to hear this.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. With me tonight, we have representatives from Albertsons Safeway and as well as our consultant team. And while we recognize we're not making a formal permit application tonight, we did want to introduce you to our site a little bit, let you know how we've thought about how the staff standards would apply here, and to show that we can, in concept, meet those standards. And we also want to show how we can propose a site that not only won't have adverse impacts on the community, but we'll actually have a community benefit. So with that, I would plan to wrap up and turn over to some others on the team, but I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Commissioner Jacks.
In terms of the merchandise, what sorts of things would be anticipated to be sold?
Commissioner, good question. And again, that's part of what we want to put some thought into, and I'll also let the Albertsons Safeway folks address it. But they have a range of support facilities with the fuel station, everything from the full convenience store down to a kiosk. And I think that their smallest kiosk is about 800 square feet, about half of which would be sales. And they are limited to items like soda, water, cigarettes, just the kinds of items that, something that customers would pick up at a market.
Any other questions from commissioners? Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
The next person we have is Henry Bassett. Ooh, charts.
That first buzz is a one-minute warning.
So you asked for a picture, right?
Yeah. Wait till they set it up and give us some time.
Is there a way we can move those up, Nate?
Okay. You can move those forward if you want, Chris.
Yeah, move them forward just a little bit, please.
General Bassett. Yeah. Ooh, thank you.
Just as long as the cameras can see.
Yeah, that's
okay. That's better that way.
So we've got that one. What's the other one going to show?
Anything?
Why don't you sit with me here? And no, I think it's going to have to be moved back.
Which one?
This one right here.
The
see where it's showing the back of it.
Or put them both over there, I think would be a better option.
Together? Would that be better?
But
actually, I think if we put them both over there.
On this side?
Well, we weren't sure which side you were talking about.
Yeah.
That way. Point them at the camera. That's
they can't see them.
Perfect.
With the audience that's here on the dais.
You can tell.
There you go.
Didn't they bring a hologram?
A hologram.
Camera, this camera. What happened to this camera?
So which, where should I put
it? Philip, you move it.
Yeah, let's actually put him back where we had him over here.
Thank you, Philip.
Vic? You got to be close enough for the commissioners to see.
Somebody turned off the camera. Yeah, because otherwise I'd have this window.
Oh.
I'll check on that later. Okay. So yeah, let's flip that around. This one and stand it right next to that one and then turn it so that camera can get it.
See, nobody needs to see this.
This is amazing. This is amazing.
Can you guys see that all right?
No.
I just carry on.
You can block me, it's okay.
Yeah, block me. I'm good.
Seriously, you can block me if you want. That's
I'll be Vanna for.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, I'm fine with
that.
No.
There you go. And then bring the other one up a little bit.
This is.
Shannon will jump up and scream, I object. He's an attorney.
Perfect. How does that work?
Beautiful.
And you guys see it okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. Considering the options.
Yes. I think we did all the options.
Well,
and there's two of you here, and do you want to introduce both here?
So my name is Henry Bashy, who you called up. I'm construction director for Albertson Safeway for the Portland Division. And I also brought up Chris Miles, who's my project manager for fuel centers for the division as well. So we're going to kind of tag team this.
So thanks for having us tonight, and do appreciate the comments so far and the comments from the chief. We, at Safeway, one of the major, not only concern, but challenges that we have is, what do the customers want? What do they want? We are constantly moving, adjusting. And in this business, if you're not changing, you're dying. Proof is right now, currently, we are remodeling that store. If you haven't been in it, we are doing a facelift on it. One of, I don't even know how many has been overdone over the years.
A lot.
Testimony in that store has been there a long time, a very long time. We don't have any plans to go anywhere. That store's, it's been good to us. The community's been good to us. And so what we're really here doing, not only tonight, but in response to several years ago, and if you were around in 2013, we gave a run at it internally as well. We never got this far, and we didn't, not for any reason from the city of Kaiser or anyone else. We just went through some changes, and there were some adjustments, and we never went forward with it. A couple of things that, couple of comments, I think Seth brought up the reason. And earlier in some of the comments, that was, this was done, a traffic survey was done years prior, it was updated, and the reason is we're updating it because 2010, 2000, 2013 models are not current to today. That is current now. Did we address the fire department things? I don't think completely that we did, but we did do is address the flow, what's happening currently as well. But predominantly the reason is the customer. One of the items that they have and we brought back after years, and maybe Henry can mention it, is our points. You have your Safeway card and you get fuel points. That's been a massive relief for our customers, but it's also drove sales for us. Having a fuel center on this site makes sense
for us simply because, one, it's already there. The fuel center site is there right now. We do not have to develop, we don't have to purchase, we don't have to modify. That has always been the intention for that Safeway to have a fuel site or an ancillary. Initially was an ancillary site because we had the entire property, but it's always been with the intention of putting fuel there. Growth, you guys are growing. You guys have this building here is unbelievable. This is a really nice building. I see new businesses coming in just diagonally from us right now in Safeway. You've got, I believe, a new apartment building coming in, multi-use. You got your roundabout. This city is busting at the seams. And the chief, it's regardless if we put this fuel center in, I think you have growth. You're in the center of town. You are literally in the center. The fire department is in the center of town. We are too, basically. It's growing, so we aren't trying to create a bigger problem. We're trying to address our customer, but we see the problems too, or the challenges, which is why we have invested a great deal of money and time making sure that we're not just coming in dropping down a bigger problem. We're trying to find out, is there a way to alleviate what our desire is, not only for us as a revenue source, but also for this business and our customer. What is it going to impact? Right now, currently, they get their fuel points. They go to Salem, I think is our closest other fuel center. They go quite a ways. You know, it's just something that we look at more than anything as, are we going to survive without fuel there? Yeah, absolutely, we'll survive without fuel. But we most likely will do something with that property. We're not going to leave it blank either. Because it's a dirt lot and it's ugly right now. So I'd like to let Henry speak on a couple of that. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Yeah, nice job, Chris, thank you. So it is in response, and I'll walk you through a couple of these photos here, but this is in response to our customers. We do the surveys. Many of you may have or have a spouse or a friend or somebody that's filled out our surveys, and weekly we get surveys. When are you going to put fuel in? When are you going to put? Why do I have to drive to Salem? I hate driving to Salem to get my points. I lose points because I don't have time to go to Salem. So we are truly responding to what our customer and the community is asking us to do, you know, and oblige that. And again, you know, we're just responding to them. The other thing I wanted to add to an earlier comment is as many of you know, Albertsons purchased Safeway a couple of years ago, and that was one of the main drivers of hitting the pause button on this, as well as a number of other potential sites that we do have. But I can tell you the enthusiasm is very high to continue to grow. We are pretty dense from our home store facilities. So from a Portland division perspective, I can share with you that fuel is a major part of our growth pattern for the coming years, just because there are a lot of Safeways. So maybe to your earlier question, do we need another fuel station? Well, we would say, do we need a Winco down the road too? Do we need another grocery store? So, you know, so I'd share that. But if I may,
I can kind of tell them too what they're looking at.
So we'll start with the pictures, because I know Chief said he hasn't seen a picture. And, well, you haven't seen the pictures. Chris will
okay, so the pictures that Henry is looking at, one of the comments that the development team wanted to have us bring, and we'll probably address some of your concerns, is what is this thing going to look like, or what would it look like? Now, so what we've done there is taken a Google Earth street map shot of the site, and we've imposed our civil engineer, who may talk later, Pedro with Terraforma, has helped us put together what that fuel center would look at. So the first picture there in the top left corner, is that
River Road?
We're looking
in River Road.
And that south entrance, or excuse me, the entrance that has the island, yeah, there where people cheat and turn left when they're not supposed to. And so we you know, we have that island put in there to help people not do that. Well, that you can see through that picture kind of where the island will be, the kiosk and fuel center will be. The next picture in the top right there is that Shumaway there?
Shumaway? Yeah, we got North River Road. That's the other side.
The other entrance. Sorry, the other entrance. So it's basically just down the same property line, this back property line next to the apartments buildings, behind the bank. And then the last picture down there is
Chamois.
Chamois, that's the island one I probably was referring to earlier. So in all cases with trees and leaves all up there, yeah, you kind of get a flavor of what the fuel center would look like. The next picture that's just showing there is a sample, maybe to drive home the point of what they look like typically. I think you all have probably got gas before, right? Everybody's got gas. So this isn't anything, this is not unique. It colors are possibly, certainly the name. This is not what this one would look like specifically. It's a general view of a typical fuel center with islands.
Blue Diamond down by Las
in
Vegas.
Las Vegas.
So from an aesthetic standpoint, some of you may have questions aesthetically, how does that fit in? And essentially, it will have the same sort of materials and finishing as the store. So they're matching the store as best we can.
The next one there is the existing site right now. That is the existing site survey right now, the Alta survey, which shows all our setbacks, and you can see where the dirt lot is. And this one next to me now, this site one, shows where we're talking the proposed area of that fuel center would go with a kiosk on the site. And again, like I said earlier in the beginning of my time, this has always been set aside for fuel, so you can see that it actually sets exactly like a fuel center would. To address the driving or the traffic and the flow, that under considerable scrutiny is not only a concern for everyone in the community, but it's also a concern. I'm sorry, is my time up here?
Do you have more to say?
I would, just to address the last picture that we have there. This picture here is a blown-up version of an idea, one of several of the intersection or the entrance that the chief mentioned at the very beginning, the one directly across from the fire station. We
fire station.
Inevitably, we always have this problem with our own entrances. The people come back and forth there, and they bump into traffic. They do. We've drawn in to accomplish the traffic flow islands in that first several parking stalls to force people into the parking lot to avoid the stacking that inevitably happens at, you know, from 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock in the evening, and from, you know, 7 to 9, whatever, someone's coming in to get their Starbucks or get a quick something. So what those islands do is it eliminates parking there, so people have to actually drive in. And in reverse, when they're either backing out or leaving, they aren't backing up, blocking traffic anymore, not only in the first lane, but also in that main entrance itself. Additionally, we were asked to look at the pedestrian, pedestrian walkway. We've also added in there additional pedestrian access, not only ADA, but you know, we kind of did a rendition. It's not specific again because we would need to see what a specific stamped concrete or some design. We've heard some things about a river road or river.
River Road Renaissance. It's
Yeah, exactly. So in order to understand what that is, we don't know what it is, so we assumed something. So either way, we are trying to address and accomplish not only your concerns, but our own customers, which are, you know, this is your community, it's our customers' community, it's our community.
I think it certainly includes the fire chief and some of their concerns as well, because our big jam is right here. People come in and they want to get into this first stall or the second stall if it's available, and then they sit and wait, and that begins the stacking immediately. And so by eliminating three, the first three on each side, because we did look at closing it off, and it would really bottleneck the whole thing. So our decision was, hey, if we take these three out, it will force them in. Even if they wait here, we'll have roughly two cars of space minimum to hold stacking off, and then they can keep going this way. The other piece is, from a handicap perspective, for those that know the store, this is on our primary entrance side, and all our handicaps are down on the second entrance. So we're actually getting a win-win by putting our handicap. We're going to put our handicap stalls here, which allows them that access on that new cement, stamped concrete, whatever we decide and agree upon for here. So they'll have direct access and safer access into the store. So again, as Chris mentioned, this is just one of the thoughtful process of what we can do to help on the traffic for the chief's concerns, and then as well as our own for both directions here. So we just wanted to give you just kind of a flavor for that. And then if I could, Commissioner Jackson, I was going to ask you one question on what kind of things that we do sell in there and potentially we'd like to sell. In our industry, we call it rapid consumables. Something that they're going to eat and they're going to be back for more. So the smaller bag snack chips, candy bars, soda water, just the grab and go coffee. That's one of the biggest things, believe it or not, in the morning at any fuel station, whether it's the smallest kiosk you got or a large one, but coffee's the number one driver in the morning for people that are getting fuel to go get on the road. So I just want to kind of follow up to your earlier question.
Thank you.
And the last thing I would, and I appreciate you giving us extra time here, but the last thing I would add to that is in our industry, our results have shown that having that coffee in the morning, those quick service items, is what drives the fuel sale. It doesn't drive more traffic. If they're going to get fuel, people are not, by and large, our models don't show it making, it doesn't pencil real well financially to just only serve fuel. And the part of that reason is it is not a good overall business for future for us to not have that ability. The reason is if we decide to sell it down the road or it becomes a inventory down the road that becomes sellable for down the future, it is not a property that people desire at all that way. It is not a desirable property anymore, believe it or not. There are customers out there that do that. Their Costco's and Fred Meyer's have a key, just the, you know, the attendant only. Their model is completely different than a Safeway. Safeway is a community-based business. They're in the communities. And so that's a different type of customer than a Costco or a Fred Meyer. Again, the fuel center model for us, we've tried to address that in every aspect. And down the road, if you would like to see it, and I'll propose it later, maybe at the next one, is our multiple different models that are acceptable by or make business sense for us. Now, within that, there are ways for us to modify within those, but we've developed several out of that. So what we're proposing or what we're showing or what you saw tonight isn't necessarily the mainstay, although I know we didn't show you one. So I appreciate your time.
Any questions from Commissioner Jacks?
Yeah, just a clarification. Did I understand the description of the handicap parking correctly? I thought I heard you say the handicap parking is now at the secondary entrance, if you will, and that parking is going to be moved over to the entrance across from the fire station?
Right now, our intent was to add.
Or to add more handicap.
We'll leave the handicap
there
on both sides for services either way.
The current handicap would stay where they're at, and there'd be more.
That's correct.
Opposite the main entrance?
Yes.
Okay. I guess another question is, what does Sherry's and the OSU Federal Credit Union say? I assume there are crossover easements because it looks like they have to go over your property to get in and out of their facilities.
As far as where the easements go, I don't know if Pedro, if we have, I don't, the easements there are well within, I'd have to double check on that, but I don't, we haven't seen any, based on our surveys, any issues with the setbacks or easement encroachments at all.
Right. Well, what does Sherry's and OSU Federal Credit Union say about having a fueling station there?
Well, I went and actually talked to the OSH, Oregon State, is it OSHU?
OSU.
OSU, sorry, Credit Union.
Be careful and here.
Yeah,
talk,
women's
yeah.
team is, have a lot of coverage
agreed.
Soon on TV. So.
Agreed. Talked with one of the managers, I think it was an assistant manager, and the only comment back she gave to me was a question, and she said, Can we hang a banner out there? Would you have a problem with us promoting their customers to, you know, against the fuel center? So, there, you know, we never really went into a deep conversation about it. It was, what was your initial response to it? But I never did get with the branch manager, so we haven't got that far yet. The Sherry's we haven't talked to yet. They share our sign, but.
Commissioner Whalen.
I'm not a traffic engineer, and it's a little bit premature to get into any sort of details, but I'm admittedly disappointed that, as I understand it, the traffic study that's done didn't address over 4,000 ingresses and egresses opposite what I consider to be your main entrance. So as we move along in this, and I'm sure that staff will require this, but it would be nice to see that there is going to be a cooperative workings with the fire district, because they serve the same customers you serve. So I just encourage that to,
sure.
to come forward.
Fair well, I agree. I think over the course of 20 some plus years, Safeway certainly has and will continue to do that. We have, like I said earlier, we have no intention of you know, leaving the community. We have every intention of staying and producing and adjusting and making sure the customers and we're a good steward and we're good neighbors. Absolutely.
Yeah, good comments, and
yeah.
we did take good notes when Chief was.
Yeah. I just want to clarify, the spot that you're talking about is where the 18-wheelers park all the time.
Which we put Jersey barriers over right now to get
but
rid of that.
That was
absolutely
okay.
Because with that came trash and debris
and
paraphernalia.
RV parking.
Yeah.
The next question is, you talked about in your design plan improvements with the ADA parking, pedestrians, with the improvements that Chamawa Road has, as well as the north part of River Road, as far as cycling facilities, what are you going to do for that?
For cycling?
For people commuting to the store to pick up things.
You know, we would need to see, we would do anything that we can do to encourage that. I mean, what that does for us as a business is it draws. We're in the business of drawing business, and not preventing that or preventing access. So we would actually need to, maybe you can help us develop what that needs to look like. If we, I mean, we've got a curved section of the sidewalk on that northeastern section of our property, and that sidewalk kind of is more of a little more aesthetically pleasing, but unfortunately, it's on the dark side of the moon.
Right.
Not very many people
cyclists,
see that.
Cyclists, people that want their bikes
Absolutely.
Parked in a safe, comfortable area with racks.
I think that's a great comment.
Yeah.
And I would just add that we're finishing up about 4 weeks from now. We're going to reopen a store, 1963 circa, Safeway in Ashland. And similar in community where there's a lot of cyclists, we did invest in a nice covered bike rack area. So not only would they be out of the rain when they shop, their bikes would dry if it was raining, but just to give you a flavor that we got all kinds of modifications that we could put, and I think that's a great comment.
I'd like to hear that. I'm also chair of the Kaiser Traffic Bikeways and Pedestrian Committee too.
Okay.
So,
yeah, great comment.
Nate,
you go.
No. Sorry.
I wanted to make sure that the commission knew that the proposal that they just showed for the entrance off of Chamawa is different than that was shown in the traffic analysis. And so our engineer has not had a chance to look at what this proposal was tonight. And it's significantly different than what was shown in the traffic analysis. And I don't know if the applicant would like to respond to why the change happened from that study.
Well,
and you are?
Good evening. My name is Chris Bramer. I'm the engineer of record for the traffic study from Kittleson Associates. Obviously, traffic's an issue, so what I'm hoping to do is give you kind of an overview with my 5 minutes, try to respond to the questions at the end, and also hit on this potential change to the driveway. When we were first invited to look at this site in 2013 for Safeway, the intent at that time was to understand where could you put a fuel on the site and where would what would the traffic implications of that be? It was intended to be an internal report. You all now have a copy of it, so you've probably had an opportunity to review it. One of the key questions at that time was, should the fuel be located directly on Chemawa or over on this larger lot where we're now situating it? And one of the conclusions at the time from that study was, move it away from the fire station, move it away from some of these issues. As we were brought back in to look at this at the beginning of 2017, really kind of started with a fresh perspective. It's a little unique in that we don't have a site development application yet, so we're really trying to project and provide an overview of issues and haven't had that real back and forth dialogue with all the different public works, fire department agencies yet. So there's a lot of information in there, but I don't consider it to be the be-all end-all, and there's been some good questions tonight. Fundamentally, we approached the study looking at both a safety and capacity perspective. The development certainly will increase traffic, no question there, and we're trying to understand what that increase will be. We can get into the details of that, but one of the key things we saw with the site plan is it's an opportunity to revisit the existing site access. As the chief noted, some of the driveways do have crashes at them today. If you've all driven or stood out there, you'll see you have a bump going in and out of them. There are some site distance limitations. Some of the driveway, particularly the main one on Chemawa, is fairly narrow, and so people pull in and then they kind of slow down or they stop, and there's pedestrians. There's a lot going on. The nice part about looking at an old site plan is there's an opportunity to revisit it, and particularly as we have a development, potentially an opportunity to reconstruct and improve. We do see a lot of opportunities for those improvements. They're outlined in the study, and we can go through them, although I don't want to use my 3 minutes to do that. I particularly appreciate Chief Cowan's perspective and their need to focus on response and safety. That's certainly very appropriate. No one's going to question that. And part of my duty as an engineer is to serve the public. That ultimately is my responsibility. As I mentioned before, we moved the fuel away from the fire station specific to address this issue. And many of the improvements we recommended for the Chemawa driveway, including the two different options that are now in consideration, would result in some improvements to that driveway. Chief Cowan mentioned the queuing or backup that's happening today westbound on Chemawa going up to the signal. That is an issue. We saw it out there, and it will continue to grow regardless of this site. I think there's some opportunities to address that. I did want to clarify with respect to the aerial photos and the chief's comment about, you know, these aren't even taken during the peak time of day. He's right. The aerial photography is what's available publicly, and typically they seem to fly those on weekends or not PM peak hour. So absolutely, those aerials are off peak. What I do want to emphasize is the traffic counts that we did for this study were during the peak hours. We count between 7 and 9 in the morning and 4 and 6 at night. We found locally that the morning commuter peak was happening at 7:05 to 8:05 at the Chemawa River Road intersection, and that it was between 4:40 and 5:40 in the afternoon peak. Specifically, the 5:25 to 5:40 was the peak on the days we were looking. During that period, we did record fire response leaving from the station. Those counts are documented in the back appendix that you'd really have to delve into to see it all, but we did record three different responses at different times during the morning peak, and two vehicles going out in the evening, although it was actually later than the commuter peak. Obviously, they go when they get the call, so it's going to be different each time. In terms of opportunities, I can't speak for Safeway, but certainly that queuing in front of the fire station needs to be addressed at some point. That will continue to grow. I've worked on similar situations with other fire departments where there are potentially opportunities to, and I don't even know what's at the fire station, so I don't want to go way in the weeds, but there's potentially opportunities to link the traffic signal to the fire station and provide an opportunity for responders to exit with control of the signal, the different things we could explore there. Bottom line is I'm willing to work with city staff and fire department should this move forward. I think there are opportunities out there. Commissioner Whalen, you asked a question about 4,000 vehicles a day, and I didn't quite know what you were referring to, so I'm wondering if you could just...
That was an annual. For the fire district.
Okay, coming out of their vehicle.
Calls a year, I think that's close.
Okay.
4,500.
Okay. All right, thank you.
That was where that number was, an annual...
Sure.
Egress
sure. If...
Couple minutes.
So the last thing I'll wrap up with is just responding to Mr. Brown's comment on two different site plan options, and we had a recommendation for the driveway in the traffic study. In talking more to the team, what we've been speaking about is there another way to do that? One of the challenges with the recommendation that we outlined is it forces everyone coming in to cross over the pedestrian area. And so today you can come in, turn right, and go down that first aisle. The recommendation we had proposed in the traffic study would bring everyone in and then give them the opportunity to turn right. There's a number of variations that could be done on the drawing that you've sent tonight. Maybe that driveway becomes a right in only one way and peel some people off. Bottom line, there's a lot of different ways to deal with this. I don't think we have to try to solve that tonight, but I think there's opportunities there. So I'll stop unless you have questions.
Anybody have questions?
I have a question.
Michael Blassie.
So you were talking, and the previous gentlemen were saying about how the layout would be to avoid the queuing of cars coming in looking for spots, and so based on what I'm seeing, you know, it looks like you're gonna have a wider entryway, right? You're widening, mm-hmm. so pedestrians will have be at risk for a longer distance, but also. Being in that for longer distance means cars will be stopped longer to get in and out. So you might have more queuing for that. And then you've got your handicap entryway, or more handicap parking, and you got that main entryway, which would, I think, also cause more queuing because obviously the cars are going to stop to let people going in and out. So sounds like there's some safety and still some queuing issues.
You know, there's a lot of different trade-offs to balance with that driveway. In a perfect world, the store entrance wouldn't be right where it is, creating that pedestrian interaction there. One of the things that I see watching the driveway today is particularly people making a left turn in, coming down Chamawa, making a left turn in, start to turn, and then if there's someone coming out of that first drive aisle inside, they pause for that. They start to turn in and there's someone coming out and it's fairly narrow and they slow down, particularly the big F-350 pickup truck kind of really slows down and there's cars coming at them. And that short throat depth turning into the site where you turn in and you've got to make a bunch of decisions in a hurry really slows down the decision process and the ability for people to navigate that quickly. With the widening distance that we're talking about, potentially adding 4 to 6 feet to the driveway, that's probably on the order of 1 to 2 seconds of walking time. So it's not a huge pedestrian impact, but you're right. Certainly someone in a wheelchair is going to take longer to roll across there. I think at the end of the day, we can, without going into the weeds, say there's definitely options to improve it. There will be trade-offs. I think with the fuel, it's important to recognize that that's not necessarily the first driveway everyone would choose to go into based on where the fuel is for the site. It might be your last choice. But part of this is a nuance of where do people go and where do they go by time of day, different flows, different queuing. Bottom line is I think there's a lot of opportunity for improvement. And there will be increased traffic. That's whether it's Safeway or another use on the site, there will be increased traffic. So we're trying to find the best way to manage it.
Okay.
Yeah. Is there a possibility for bringing in traffic off of Chamawa behind the store? Is that, I noticed that it showed a driveway on one of the, I know that's probably truck traffic back there for shipping and receiving.
It's a great question. It's one that comes up often with Safeways, and I'll defer to the Safeway folks on who for sure they want going back there. We see people today, some people have learned that that's a nice way to get in and around the site. In terms of advertising it, it's a little bit of a slippery slope because you do have the loading areas out there, and we don't necessarily want people to feel that that's the quick plays around the site, go through fast and bypass everything. That drive aisle back there is fairly narrow, and so you do have the trucks and people working with pallets and things back there. Yes, there are people using it today. I wouldn't be comfortable saying we should be signing that and promoting use of that for customer traffic.
Okay. Commissioner Jacks.
The changes to the parking layout that we've seen tonight seem to be just kind of really focused on that one entrance across from the fire station. Has there been any playing around with a CAD program in terms of reorienting the entire parking arrangement?
So we have, at least within Kittleson, looked at a few different options. We didn't put them all in the report. Again, just kind of where do you draw the line with what's reasonable for this preliminary report. But we've actually looked at all four driveways and have identified improvements of each of them. We've considered changing aisles from one-way to two-way. Should we look at 90-degree parking? A lot of different variations that could be out there. So yes, there are other opportunities out there, and our recommendation would be to address all four of the driveways in terms of reconstruction. I've been focused on the one across the fire department because that obviously is a key one, but they all have the a good opportunity to improve.
So that response I heard was in terms of the driveways. What about the parking, the arrangement of the aisle, drive aisles and the parking spaces in the parking lot itself? Is there any other rearrangement other than just a minor little change at the entrance across from the fire station?
If there would be, certainly over by the fuel station itself, there would be some reconfiguration happening to create the space for the fuel station. And I think if there's particular suggestions you all have to or others have in terms of recreating overall parking layout, I'm certainly willing to entertain them. I don't have one to present to you tonight.
But has there been any back in the office?
Yes, we've looked
playing around to see if there's anything else.
Yeah, in particular, we looked at between the two driveways on Chimawa, where you've got the right in, right out, and then the main access. We looked at potentially converting that to 90-degree parking along that whole aisle, or potentially making the whole thing one-way southbound. Right now, it's two-way, so you have people going up to the store and people coming down. Mm-hmm. One of the advantages of going to one-way southbound is you don't have people coming up right to the main drive aisle and then trying to turn and interact with that whole field. So that's the area we've spent the most time looking at.
Yeah, I was kind of thinking that as you're coming in on that main entrance, and if you're wanting to park in the first aisle, you take that quick right, and if that was one-way westbound, mm-hmm. double-loaded, or even just single-loaded, mm-hmm. that I don't know how much that would help in terms of, you know, not creating a backup, but.
I think it would help, and the idea that was shown earlier tonight, the idea of potentially making that right turn, and the one shown tonight was two-way, but making that whole aisle one-way down or west has some benefits. The disadvantage to it is that now you've basically committed that customer to going all the way down the parking lot as opposed to the two-way flow, but from a pure, how does it impact that driveway closest to Chimawa? I see it as a benefit.
Yes, Jim.
How many, maybe not for you as the engineer, but how many pumps are likely needed to make it work financially? I assume if you could only work two or three pumps in, you'd say, oh, that's not going to be any good. We need at least a dozen or 16 or whatever.
Sure. So the easiest answer is to look at it in terms of islands, because one island would constitute two pumps, one on each side. So there would be three islands, so six pumps, right? Or a combination of six islands, which is 12 pumps. So you have one, two, three, four, five, six. We would never do a three island configuration, and most people don't do that anymore because you get trapped in that center island. So we have a model for both. What we would be proposing on this one is a six island, and the six island actually flows that traffic much quicker. It gets them out much quicker than a three because of stacking. Most three island or six pump configurations is for a very small site where it just jammed up, you don't have anything, and they really have no other alternative. So again, the six island moves people, boom, very fast, very quickly. And you don't necessarily get any more sales out of that. You're just getting the customers through faster.
And the last outside the box question, any thought of having the blocked off entrance to Sixth Avenue on the south side of the site opened up? I assume the residents that live back there would not like it, but if we're thinking about big picture, what's possible?
That's on the
has
south
there been
property.
Any consideration of Sixth Avenue
well, the back
opening
of the store.
Up
the back corner?
I think we might have more people here at that meeting if you. We haven't looked at that. No.
There is a pedestrian access.
Right.
Yeah. Access.
Yeah. There's pedestrian. Yeah. There is pedestrian access.
We do need cycling access through there. There's pedestrian, but you try doing it steps with a bike.
Load it down.
Or going up.
Absolutely.
Yes. You break the eggs, you know.
Scrambled when you get home.
Mr. DeBlasi.
Thank you. I believe it was the gentleman on my right. You said that that if it weren't a gas station, you have plans or something else. Or
we don't have specific plans, no, but the plans that are out there is to not leave it the way it is.
Okay.
The way it is now is, I think, tolerated, for lack of a better word. It's a blank dirt lot. And to the gentleman who I forgot his name earlier, who mentioned as a business owner, to have a vacant lot that isn't generating anything is that's an anchor. And not only that, it's not aesthetically pleasing. We're not going to put asphalt in there. We really, even though we do have a lot of parking, but at 5 o'clock, you know, there have been several comments the parking lot's jam-packed. It still doesn't make sense based on our data to add more parking to that site. We just don't have the numbers collectively to do that. So we wouldn't even put asphalt and put parking on there. We would most likely sell it, parcel it off, or put a business and become the landlord. We sublease too as well. We have different options that we in our real estate group. We don't have a specific plan though, other than like I said, we will do something with it other than what it is.
So if we were to not approve the change, then it's not as if Kaiser would get, it's not a zero sum sort of thing.
No, it doesn't. If you don't approve this, and we're hoping that you don't look at it as we're coming in, putting our thumb on it. That's not what we're doing. We're even trying to do. We're letting you know from a business perspective, we don't have any intention of leaving an empty lot. You have to know that. We want to develop it. We want to be responsible doing it either way. So if one doesn't make sense, we will survive.
Yeah.
We're all big people here, and we're adults. We can survive this, but we will do something else with it, though, for sure.
And absolutely. One final thing. So then the fact that this was never built on, and you mentioned that, or one of you, that it was always thought there'd be a gas station there. Mm-hmm. Was that always considered the location then?
I don't think so.
There was technically the original location was actually the front of the lot on the Chamawa side, on the side of the facing the closest to the fire department.
Okay.
On that end, so it's the same route we're talking about, making it a south only lane. So we had room in there to do that, and then conversely change the pad into parking and put the fuel there. But from a top line, fuel's been our focus for probably eight years on that particular piece of land. So.
And I would just add, an ideal location for a fuel site is not where it is, where we're even proposing, either one. An ideal location is in the corner on a busy street. This is a community-based this is a community. We are not off the highway. It is not a commute if you're going from Portland to Salem. This is not anywhere close. So this is purely a community-based business. If you know you got to get fuel, if you know where you got to get groceries, up until Hagen's was here or Albertson's, Safeway's always been here, and eventually I think the Winco will go. If you know it's there, you're going there. You don't have to be told if you live here, where's that Safeway? Oh, turn on, you're not, and the same would be true with the fuel. If you know you're going to get fuel and you're going to use your points, you don't need it to be on the corner to go, oh, there's the fuel center right there. You know where it's going to be.
Sorry for kind of a one more question. What would happen to the post office boxes that you can drive up to and drop your things off? I think the only place in Kaiser where you can drive up and drop your mail without having to get out of the car, park, walk up.
That's a great question.
We'll get back to you on that.
Well, not only that, but if you, you know, one, actually that was actually addressed by, and I don't see Sean here tonight, our fuel center person actually brought that to my attention. And if you'll notice, one of the kiosk actually sets away from the back property line. And the building does. And that would be a prime location to actually, and there's no parking back there either, by the way. That would be a prime location to relocate and stay away from not only the grocery traffic, but the fuel traffic too. And you'd have a, and if you were really smart and you knew that back aisle, back road existed, you can probably not even make a single turn until you get to that bike path and make that left-hand turn to get out. Yeah. So yeah, there's a lot of options, and like Chris Bremer brought up, you have lots of options there and opportunities.
I'm glad you mentioned that, Jim. That is a Kaiser icon. It is. How many people on this commission have used that?
All the time.
Yeah. The only really other one. They don't have one at the post office. You got it. The only other one is right out here in front of City Hall.
So I think what we're hearing from the commission is not only are these opportunities, unless we are completely aware of those, they get overlooked. Little things get overlooked, but little things are a big thing if removed. So what that is maybe our biggest point. Our biggest point is Safeway is we're addressing not only you, but our customer, which is still you. I mean, I would imagine some of you or all of you shop at one time or another at the Safeway. And you've already mentioned that saw lots of nods about the traffic and the flow. And now we're getting into the weeds about little things. But those little things matter. And we're willing to address those and try to find that opportunity. And they're very easily handled.
You have a question?
Yeah.
How important are the merchandise sales?
In fuel? At the fuel
center?
For
the fuel island.
Absolutely none at all. They actually drive additional sales for us.
No, how important is it to have the kiosk?
The kiosk is important because if you are a fuel consumer, and I'm not going to pretend like you're not, and I know you are, so don't take that as I'm not, but a fuel consumer, by and large, in our research, does the quick serve. The majority of them do. If you're going to buy fuel in the morning on your way, you're going to get coffee, or you're going to get that pack of cigarettes if you smoke, or you know whatever it is, a quick something out of there while the attendant, because in Oregon and other states that we have fuel centers, you can leave your vehicle, or it's a little more difficult to leave your vehicle because you got to stay at the pump. But in Oregon, you have the attendant, so you can leave your vehicle and go in and get something real quick and get out. That sale, though, for us, really does absolutely nothing for us. It's not another one. But the double-edged sword to that is if we don't offer that, we actually lose the fuel sale altogether.
It's actually reverse from
it's reverse.
Thought. Yeah. Is you get the groceries, they're going to come to your grocery store. Well, if I put groceries in the fuel center, I'm not getting them. They're not coming to get something inside this little room and then go back out and pump their gas. So it works in reverse. Having those rapid consumables, as we call them, just a small variety even is paramount to maintaining fuel customer loyalty. as a whole, and it is a big part of our business model on that.
There is a very clear difference between wrap consumables, and I think we probably, our view of that is a little different than, because we're in that world, but I should clarify that we're not talking about the heated foods, burritos, things that cause grease, you know, you have to use grease interceptors for, three compartment sinks for, those are not included in that, because that's a different type of, that's a more of a convenience store option or item where people would park, get in, maybe spend a little more time in there. Those items are not included in that. We do have that as an option. Certainly, we go all the way up to a fairly large where we have sit down, people can sit and have lunch there as well. But the 800 square foot kiosk is in and out, and usually they're in and out before the fuel is done pumping.
Do you realize how many coffee shops are in that block?
We have one of them in our store.
Yeah.
Starbucks. Yes, we're very aware.
And a new one coming.
Yeah, we have a new, bigger one. And the old one's going to go away, by the way.
Okay, there's another coffee shop going in across the street.
Coffee's hot right now.
Yeah,
coffee's.
The other question is more for the,
coffee's
the
hot.
Engineer. In your study, did you also include transit? Because there are bus stops right on Chemawa and River Road. How would they impact traffic and stopping and things like that? And have you talked with the transit district on their input on this?
So we have not spoken with the transit district with respect to it. And at this point, we have not accounted for the delay associated with a bus serving those individual stops. What we've looked at is they're in the actual traffic counts in terms of the buses are part of the traffic counts, but we've not specifically looked at and isolated how long does the bus dwell at the stop when it's picking up a passenger.
Because we have them on both sides of River Road, right. And there's a stop right there close to
the main entrance.
Safeway.
Mm-hmm.
Also, so that would, you know, that's when we're talking about the whole traffic pattern, I think you want to include transit, the fire district, and their traffic, bike and pedestrian.
It's a fair comment, and I think if this were to move forward and we were to move into a typical site development application, those conversations would absolutely be part of the final traffic study for a site development application.
Because I know I've received complaints with the buses stopped so long, you know, on there. And we have to take that into consideration in where the driveways are, the pedestrian walkways. Okay. Mm-hmm. Was there?
That was part of my comment was, in the evenings, there's stack up of double buses at times in front of Sherry's just because of the timing. So those two buses will block, just the buses themselves will block the first exits between Sherry's and the OSU Credit Union. Mm-hmm. And so that, it gets pretty bad for even people trying to turn right into the right. First entrance. So mm-hmm. Just a comment.
Any other? Well, thank you.
Thank you all.
The next person we have is Pedro de Guzman. How was the weather up in Seattle? Is it getting sunny up there?
Not at all. All my job sites are going to hell from all this water. I'm Pedro de Guzman, a civil engineer for Terraform and Design Group. I figured I'd earn my keep driving all the way down here, so I should talk. they've asked me to look at this site. I've done many fuel stations and Safeway stores, and traffic and access are critical to any grocery store. And with all retail businesses, Walgreens, fast food restaurants, access for their customers into the site with the least amount of restrictions is always their ideal thing. So anything that we're doing to restrict access gives them heartache, but you know, Safeway's willing to work and make some sacrifices to make this site safer and helpful to emergency services. A couple things I've worked on to help out this site is that driveway width on Chemowa is 35 feet wide. That's two lanes out plus one lane in. So that in entry lane is 12 feet wide. Well, 12 feet wide is great for a traffic lane going straight, but when you're trying to make a turn a right in or a left in from the opposite side, that is fairly narrow. So when traffic's bad, it's dark. Someone making that turn in with a 12-foot lane is difficult, and any it becomes a pinch point. So what we've done is widen that from 35 feet to about 42 feet. That's 7 extra feet. That allows for people entering to swing in a little bit quicker with less risk. And hopefully, in the end, that means less fender benders that involves emergency response. So we would expect that that traffic incident, accident incident rate there would be reduced. We'd also, I see there a tree just to the left of the driveway. We'll do everything we can to remove any site distance obstructions so we clean up that view so that people can pull out safely knowing that there's no car coming right into them and causing an accident. It drives me crazy when I drive into a grocery store and someone just has to stop to try to get that first stall, even though there's 20 stalls all across the site. Drives me crazy. So there's a couple jurisdictions that say you cannot have a parking stall within 50 feet of the entrance into the private property. And so that's what I've done here is simply remove stalls, which is opposite of what any retail company wants to do. They want as many parking stalls as they want. I've told them to sacrifice some stalls, make this thing safer, make people get further into the site before they stop and want to get that first stall available. So that's what I've done there. And sorry, it's kind of a crude drawing. It was just a quickie that I did. The second thing that we've done here is simply, again, extending the length to the first stall. Also, for that first aisle, removing the left out from that first aisle. And what that does is you don't have that large truck that wants to make a left exiting the site, and all of a sudden he's blocked the entire intersection, entire lane, and he's bottlenecked everything, and everyone has to wait for that truck to get out. And so by eliminating that movement, that's one less possibility for a bottleneck. So again, no left out from that first drive aisle. We could also, not everyone obeys the rules, obviously, so we could do some traffic buttons or possibly even some cones or something just to force people to obey that movement. The question was asked, you know, do we really need another fuel station in the area? No, you probably don't, but by having a fuel station in conjunction with a grocery store, we all need to get gas. We're going to get gas somewhere. Does this increase traffic here? Yes, but that also means that's one less. When I leave, get my groceries, I need to go to the gas station. Now I don't have to make another left turn into another fuel station, which is another possibility for an accident. That's two less, one less trip in, one less trip out at another fuel station, and that's a reduction of a possibility for an accident. So I think there's a safety factor there.
Another couple.
If we can also, if there is a possibility, and this is beyond my pay grade, but there's a possibility that we can reconfigure that signal to work with the fire station to work the signal so they can clear traffic, that's something we're willing to pursue to improve the workings of the fire department. Aesthetics, I did the aesthetic renderings of the elevations. I think ideally they want it at the intersection, but I think it will be set back away from the road, so I don't think you're really going to see this all that well. It won't be the eyesore of having a fuel station right on the street. And lastly, again, as far as the benefit to the public, which we're all striving for, I'm a parent of a 3 and a 7-year-old. You pick the kid up from karate class, you got to get dinner, so you go to the Safeway store, and now you got to get gas. Well, again, not having to make that another trip to a gas station, if you can just conveniently get that right at your grocery store, it's just a benefit, it's an asset for your public, for your parents in the end. And so that's what we're striving for.
Any questions? Michael.
So you had said that with the wider entryway and I don't know if you said the wider center lane turn lane?
Will be a wider entry lane.
Okay. So you could have faster turn-ins and then remove trees for longer site distance.
Correct.
You're from Seattle?
You said? Correct.
Yeah. So you've done the research, you've seen that the current understanding in urban streets is to slow the cars down, not take all this line of sight things. So basically you're forcing drivers to go slower. So it sounds like what you're proposing is old mentality of urban streets, not current. And I really think we've already had, as the fire chief said, injuries there. I think by having cars going in and out faster, we're gonna end up with more injuries and maybe a death. So that's my say on that.
There's two sides to look at that. When you have simply a 12-foot wide entry lane, it becomes so narrow that it's a pinch point to where making that movement's more. I'm not saying it's not gonna be a 20-foot wide drive aisle to where you can pull in at 30 miles an hour and skid and turn. We're talking about just making it a few extra feet so that someone in a big car won't get pinched by someone else hugging the left lane out. We're giving them a little bit extra room to be able to make that turn in with extra safety. So it's not going to be so wide that they can go fast, but it'll be wide enough that someone making a right turn in, it's a tight right turn in. There's not a lot of radius on that right turn in. By giving them more room, hopefully you won't, they won't have to necessarily get pinched to where they create a fender bender from someone behind them.
Any other?
This isn't necessarily for you, but is there any possibility in redoing the store, you know, in any upgrades to the stores, moving the entrance to the other location and taking it away from Shamawa Road?
No, that major entry and the signage there was an agreement years ago with the city of Kaiser to leave that. No, there isn't. That would require an enormous amount of financial commitment that there's really no way for us to financially justify doing that. I think it still doesn't address overall, I don't believe it would address the traffic growth that Kaiser is experiencing. It may relieve maybe, or it may adjust people if they know that the main entry is over here. That doesn't mean somebody comes in. That what that does more than anything is it provides a visual for the customer that we're directing them into that spot. But in a community-based grocery store, you don't just go into it because it's called the major entry. Just because it has a bigger front or the S is above that one, you're going to go into either one of them. So I don't believe it really addresses the traffic. It just maybe addresses just the aesthetics of it. So we wouldn't commit to that.
Yeah, it just seems to me like you're taking away the bottleneck, pedestrians and all the cars coming in all in within, you know, 50 feet of the road, moving it to the other side of the store. But yeah, I understand it's a huge change because you'd change the whole flow of the store inside to move it, you know, to the other side of the store.
But it was we're no stranger to changing our flow, for sure, on the inside of the stores. We do that quite a bit, and you're right. But most of that is driven by what makes sense, not only to our customer, but also as a business. Does it make sense? And right now, that's not even... hasn't even been part of a discussion. Matter of fact, I'm not even aware, other than if we decide that a store should be relocated on a site. If that makes sense, we will do that. And I've done it myself several times where we've actually kept store open, built the site 90 degrees from where it currently is, and then dropped the other one down because it made better sense for flow and traffic and visibility and drove sales. On this site, doesn't make sense to do that.
Yeah. Well, that happened. That store was in a different location 30
That's
years
exactly
ago.
Exactly what you just said.
So exactly. Somebody had the great idea.
It was
right?
Pietro's and go. Safeway next to each other.
That's right. Yeah. And so, Kowalski Sister Coffee Shop.
Yep. Now, stick around.
And Pietro's Pizza.
Stick around because that could still happen at some point. So.
Yeah, my thought is that both stores that I go to in Bend their entrances are on the right-hand side. So I just envisioned that, thinking, well, why not just make them on the right, help alleviate the traffic? Because that's, you know, when I go to that store, that's what I see. I have a big truck. I pull into the Shimabu Road because I come from Kaiser Station area. And when I turn in with my big truck, I can't turn into the first lane because I can't make that turn when there's a car there. So I have to go down to the second or the third one to even get in with my truck. So I'm just speaking from my experience.
I like parking with the 18-wheelers.
Yeah. Yeah, one of our top topographicals still shows the Google Earth of 18-wheelers still parked in that site. Yeah.
Shannon, you had your hand up.
No, I was just going to, on Mr. Miles and Kyle's question, that's what happens when you're around here too long. I believe that Safeway did not want to have their entrance there. They wanted it further towards the middle of the store when that store was built, but the transportation planning rule required them to have it close to Chihuahua. So that's my recollection anyway.
On the River Road frontage, the southern driveway, it has a severe dip so that cars almost have to come to a stop so they don't go bouncing as they enter and leave the site. Is that part of the plan to smooth that out so cars can just curve on in there without having
going,
almost come to a stop?
Yeah, without going into too much detail, yes.
Good, thank
you. Every one of them are very, that was number one, at the very least, flatten those out, spread them out a little bit, yes.
And I'll kind of end it, but my question on that same entryway, during most of the traffic, that is in effect a right turn only because of the traffic on River Road.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Correct.
And I have seen tremendous issues where somebody wants to, and they go out into the suicide lane, and it truly is the suicide lane. And you know, if you're thinking that's going to be a multi-entryway, there's going to be an accident there. But that's enough comments. Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next person I have is Pam Rushing. Thank you.
Hi.
Good evening.
My name is Pam Rushing. I'm with Coldwell Banker Commercial, and I'm really here tonight to talk more about the overlay zone than Safeway, but I will give you my two cents about Safeway, and that I am not from Kaiser. I live in South Salem. I do shop at Safeway, and from a consumer point of view, being able to shop and get your gas and also get those points and save money for your gas, it's a big deal. So that's just my thoughts on Safeway. I know that there's a lot of other issues besides that. So first of all, I've been really fortunate. I've worked a lot in Kaiser. I've represented a lot of landlords and property owners and tenants here in Kaiser. And the last few years, I think you probably all know, it's been really hard to attract national tenants, credit tenants to River Road area. All the really big national tenants, they have just really shied away from River Road. They've all wanted to go to out to Kaiser Station, and it really hurt the business owners on River Road. And that trend is kind of starting to change now, and we are starting to get national tenants that are looking. I mean, you look at Schoolhouse Square, and you see, you know, national tenants that are coming in there. And so I really feel like I'm really here tonight to urge you to look at that overlay zone and see how it can change, and whether you remove it or whether it's a conditional use permit that you allow businesses to try to come into town. And an example of that is the Bank of Cascades building. It has a drive-through. We have a food user that would like to go in there, but you can't do a food user drive-through. You can only use a drive-through for a bank or for an office building. So if there's some way to look at that and do a conditional use permit, it really would help the business owners, people in Kaiser, that that'll help them and help the downtown be more vibrant. And so that's all I really have to say.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time. I don't know if you have any questions for me.
Any questions from the commissioners? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Peter Tom?
I wasn't here to speak, but I'm actually the participant that has the business that Pam just discussed.
Oh, okay.
I would like to influence you to consider the
if you want to talk, you need probably come in. Come on up. That way it gets recorded.
Well, we came to, my name is Peter Thomas. I'm from Eugene, Oregon. I represent a party that was looking at a piece of property here in Kaiser. And part of the issue at this point is the overlay here, that we wouldn't be able to put our drive-through with a restaurant use. And so I would like to make my recommendation, as it's personal, that you would consider some ability for us to try to, whether it be a openly removal of the overlay or a conditional use, so that we could demonstrate the usefulness of coming to Kaiser and being part of the community. So when I signed up, I didn't realize I was going to speak, but if there's,
thank you very much. Okay. Is there any questions from the commissioners? Thank you very much.
Right, real fine.
I think we've gotten everybody tonight. I hope I didn't miss anybody. Yeah, I'm going to close the public. Yes.
Chair, just to double check, you should probably ask if there's anybody else who would like to testify. And then the question of opening or closing the hearing, you may remember that the representative of Safeway had a request with regard to a continuance that the commission may want to consider. It's totally up to you. Why don't you double check there's no one else to testify?
Is there anybody here testifying either way or generally?
Okay. So my recollection of what the request was is if it has to do more specifically with the kiosk, what Safeway representatives are calling the kiosk issue, which apparently is fairly important to them. So the request was whether or not to continue the hearing to allow them to present further evidence of that, if that's something that you're going to consider not allowing. Totally up to the commission on whether you want to allow that continuance or not. So,
kind of a discussion here.
So we also, there is new traffic information,
yes,
that our engineer has not advised us on. We also heard some concerns about the lack of information about the conflict with the fire station. And I don't know, I'm not sure what the appropriate response is there, but those are the questions that I heard in addition to.
I also would like to hear something from the transit district too.
And okay, that's as well, something from the transit district. So we do have some questions that are, I don't believe, are resolved as a result of tonight's discussion.
Would it, my next question is, if we put this off to the next meeting, do we have agenda space for that?
Yes, we do.
And we could get out the necessary.
Well, no additional notice would be required other than our typical notice of the meeting.
So at this point, I'm looking at the commissioners here. I think the suggestion is not to close the hearing, but to continue it.
And if I could, Mr. Chair, you can do that by looking up and down and making sure there's no objection.
Does it have to be unanimous?
No. If you're going to do it without a vote, needs to make sure that there's consensus, that's all. So if there's no objection.
Josh, are you nodding?
I can continue.
Continue.
Okay.
I don't think we need to, but I won't hold it up.
Okay. So I'm hearing, and I agree that I want to hear some more, especially the other governmental entities that are involved, the transit and the fire district, and looking at the more traffic study. So I'm inclined.
Didn't want you to say that it's being continued because I had a comment before we actually continue it.
No, I'm not saying that yet.
Okay, good.
Go ahead.
No, okay. One of the things in the staff discussion or the staff report is trying to kind of take a big look at this. And so what we've had tonight is a couple hours of really detailed looking and very little big picture looking. And so what's kind of rolling around in my mind is, the overall, the overlay, and how big is it? Where is it? Mm-hmm. It's obvious it's on this property. And it sounded like from the testimony, it's the also left. On the as far north as the bank of the Cascades.
I don't know. We can come back with the actual drawing if it's not in the packet. It's kind of odd.
It's a little bit
odd shape.
Yeah, we show it on our zoning map for convenience, but truly that section 2.110.05, it actually describes it by street and location, and that's the official where it exists, because the uses are, it's not a true overlay zone, but it's literally a prohibited areas that are on the west side of River Road between James Street and, or the east side of River Road between James Street and Claggett that front upon River Road, and on the west side with the line that runs, whatever it says, off the end of Elizabeth up to just this side of, basically Simonka's Place, basically.
We could have a map showing what that is.
Yep.
That would help me a lot.
And for me, what I want to know is why.
Why?
Yeah,
what, the history?
Why. Yeah, the history. I have respect for the city council and the planning commission back in 95. They had some reasons for doing that. And it might not apply anymore. I heard that.
So,
but what brought about that in the first place?
Sure.
You don't have to answer that tonight.
Yeah, it's hard. We kind of tried to, and it's a little difficult because, honestly, that restriction area came into being in 1995, and I did not work here then. No, I was out, just barely, but I was out of high school. Shannon was around in 1995, but I've worked here longer than Nate. Yeah. And so I think part of it was around 95 and 96, John Morgan was the community development director at the time, and they were pursuing rewriting the development code, which was ultimately adopted in 98. But I know from history, the sign code rolled in 96, and they basically created this prohibited area, and I'll let Shannon or Nate jump in and correct me if I'm wrong, but I did do quite a bit of research on it before for a couple different reasons because of some other development that's happened in the district as well. So in 96, the sign code came and got adopted, and it got adopted before the development code, and then it got rolled in. The prohibition, which limited these uses, which were tied to a zone in our old zoning code, which was the zoning code from 87 to 98, they created it, and in part, I believe it was in part because of where the Urban Renewal District area was, because the ordinance that adopted the original language talked about preserving urban renewal opportunities. It also talked about through in not just the ordinance, but also the findings adopting that, which clearly are not the ordinance, but you can kind of try to look in your crystal ball. But looking at things that we're looking at more pedestrian-oriented developments, and then anecdotally, what I've always heard, and if you're a longtime Kaiser person like me, where our fountain is, yep, and where the Titus has expanded, there was a gas station that went bad, and there was a bunch of environmental issues, and I believe the city paid some money. And so ultimately, I think it was a response of, we don't want, and I think it was leadership at that time, we don't want another gas station in this area, because this one is now out of there and was an eyesore and caused problems and all of those things. So, I mean, I think that's in part the history. And, you know, we tried to include some information in there. And frankly, Hirsch, I think, you know, as the guy who kind of looked at writing the something for you guys to consider tonight, and I know there was lots of options and it was long, but it is difficult, because to wrap your head around it completely, there's a reason that this restriction area has been on our list of things to look at with you guys as Planning Commission as to if it is still appropriate, if it should be modified, if it should be eliminated, if it should be changed. And frankly, if we weren't in the midst of this TGM grant to look at these area restriction overlays and to look at different opportunities for redevelopment and creating certain opportunities for a mix of residential and business uses, and, you know, ultimately looking at maybe pulling off the whole cap and looking at some areas that say, hey, we're going to do things a little differently in these areas. If we weren't right in the middle of, well, really right at the beginning of that process, I think we would probably be much more apt to push for that really large policy conversation that Jim is kind of alluding to and really push that envelope. I just personally feel that it's premature, and it doesn't, with the grant process, there's going to be a lot of public involvement. There's going to be a lot of meetings. There's going to be a lot of expertise brought in to look at not only, you know, just what's there, but what could be there. And so anyway, but yeah, go ahead, Nate.
If the purpose of this meeting were to have that bigger look with that overlay district, we would be having this room full of a lot more people. Our process would have been different. We would have notified many more properties. We would have engaged many more citizens groups. This proposal before you is a very specific text amendment to allow basically accessory gas station with a grocery store. That, though it does have big implications, and we understand those implications. We understand exactly why Safeway is investing these resources. So it is very important. We have, however, been very successful in competing for a grant at the TGM, with the TGM program, to have that big look and have that big public involvement. It may be that we get to the point, as Shane is describing, that this overlay district has outlived its purpose. This is, however, one of the very foundational principles that our development code incorporated when it was created. I am very reluctant to just simply say, based on a specific application for one property, let's just undo that code. It just is not right. And we may be back here in a year, because this process is kicking off today. Mm-hmm. Well, not today, but. And so we do plan to engage this entire group and this entire area.
Through the TGM.
Through the TGM process. Okay. So I just want you to understand We are sympathetic. We understand. I think Ms. Rushing's description that we do want national change. We do want business to be encouraged and developed on River Road. We are invested in the success of River Road. But there is a process and there is a way to do that. And just to simply say, you know, I think a driveway should be okay, is not that process. That's my plea to you. So
thank you. Yeah, this is a big issue that needs to be addressed. At the same time, one of the community partners has invested a lot of time and resources to see how they can grow their business and benefit our community as well. And so I don't want to slow that process down because we want to take advantage, I think, of their enthusiasm to further invest in our community. Having said that, if we're going to come back in a month and continue this process, I would like to see all the other parties, you know, the fire district, the transit district, whoever else might not have been aware of this until just basically today, that they be given the opportunity to have the information, whether it comes from Safeway or whether it comes from staff or whoever, but I want to make sure that they're communicating, because, you know, like in the case of the fire district, even though Jeff is here tonight, he answers to a board, and their board meets once a month. And when is that, Jeff?
Tuesday the 21st.
Okay. So, you know, if they could have some of this information, specific information, for their board meeting, it might help their board members to, you know, give the message they want Jeff to convey to us. And the same thing from the transit district.
Sure. So. And I would encourage actually the applicant to be in communication with the fire chief, particularly on the traffic issues. I'm pretty sure the firemen shop at Safeway.
Oh my goodness, they don't.
Where else can they go? Yeah. So yeah. I don't think it's a brand issue. I think that his concerns, if you can provide additional clarification for the fire district, I think that would be very helpful.
So another little part of what's rolling around in my mind is kind of what we've been talking about. Why is the overlay there? And I'm kind of thinking that, well, back then there was an urban renewal district, and it did some wonderful things, like put all those terrible power and telephone lines underground and built a decent street, curbs, gutters, sidewalks, and things like that. And so the urban renewal district isn't along River Road anymore, as I understand it. And that was going to be part of building a downtown. And where was the downtown going to be? Out at Lock Haven and River Road, Chamawa and River Road, Sam Orcutt Way and River Road.
Now it's
well,
Safeway.
Where? And so the overlay was an effort to have some particular regulations that could, I guess you could say, help or encourage a downtown. But I'm trying to think.
95, 2017.
Yeah, I'm trying to think in the last, well, I've been here for, what, 3 years now, and I'm trying to think when the last two-story building was built on River Road, and I think it's the retirement center down by Sonic at that end of the corridor. And so for whatever reason, we, despite trying to have some kind of a downtown pop up somewhere in some form, even if it was just one building to start, I haven't seen one building that's two, let alone three stories, that could lead anyone to say, oh, here comes a multi-story downtown on this portion of River Road. Yeah. So
I think we have it in our plans to encourage that,
yeah.
But
it's never happened.
Yeah, it just hasn't
the market hasn't yet. Bore it out. It's been 20 years.
Well, anyway, that's just another aspect. And one other thing, too, is I don't know how many customers Safeway has, even, you know, like on a daily basis or whatever. how many residents in the city go to Safeway, but I do know that other than the little bit of the north end of town that's in Fire District 1, there's roughly about 36,000 customers that the fire district has. And so they are there 24 hours a day, and certainly they probably don't have a big problem getting in and out of their station in the middle of the night when somebody has an emergency, a medical emergency. But certainly at the AM and PM peak hours, I think we
definitely want to see that county in a cooperation with the fire district. Michael, you had one?
Yeah, I just wanted to say, it sounds like there's, you know, the consensus here is, 20 years ago, those silly folks with their Pollyannish ideas of a downtown city center. Well, I can think of two words, the reason why we haven't had more development downtown, and that's Kaiser Station. That's been the pressure valve release to get development there rather than on River Road, so.
Well, to move things on, and I think I got agreement, I'm not going to close the hearing tonight and continue it to the April meeting.
That will be April 12 at 6 o'clock.
Same place, same station. So, I'm not hitting the gavel. I'm not hitting the gavel. So, thank you all for your presentation and answering our questions. You have a kind of an idea of what we're looking at and the kind of questions we're looking at. And Nate's suggestion about working with the fire department and transit, finding out those kind of things, since a lot of your customers get dropped off by the bus right there. So, thank you. Moving on, new old business. Anything, Nate?
Nothing pressing in the interest of the hour. Our grants are moving forward in the process. We are working on them. It's frustratingly slow, but we are continue to work on them.
Now, my understanding,
there's
a
liaison
transportation report. Open house on April 25th.
Yes. That's correct. Yes.
We're all invited.
It is for the revised RTSP, Regional Transportation System Plan. It is updated every 3 years, and I can't believe it's here again.
Okay.
Yes, so there's open house, and if anybody's interested in a flyer, we have them here at City Hall, or you can go to the Mid-Willamette Valley Council of Government website and get the information there as well.
Staff report?
Yeah, sorry. I always get those two confused, as you know.
Yeah.
Nothing more.
Nothing more. Council liaison.
I just have a couple of things. We now have youth counselors that are coming into the program, and our objective is to have one for every committee, including the Planning Commission. To get them up to date. So look forward, hopefully, to that within the next year. We approved the Boy Scout campery down at Kaiser Rapids Park again. So we're going to be doing a lot of work down there for us.
They
do a lot of work, yes.
Invasive species.
That's correct. And then we had our public hearing on the Section 2.311, the planned unit development, and we passed that through the council. So then we had long and short range planning the other night, and that's kind of all that's been going on. Not a lot.
Thank you very much. Council representative for...
Can I ask one question?
Yes, yeah. Go ahead.
Do you have questions?
Well, I may have missed what you may have already covered it, but I believe today is the last day of the...
Oh, that is correct. At midnight tonight. Isn't that right, Debbie? Midnight tonight, yep.
What is the work plan and decision time? Are they going to make a decision on Monday or is it a month from now?
I think that we're hearing something at the first of April meeting. Shannon, did I read that today or no? No? Okay. I think the objective is to bring something to the table the first week in April. I think that was our original plan, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And I think
I wasn't quite sure if it was the first or second meeting in April.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Sometime next month, yeah.
And that will come after the Parks Board tallies?
Yes, because tonight's the last night at midnight, and so then they're going to, I guess, go back, they're going to tally everything, and then they have to present a report to us at the council.
Thank you.
Yeah. You're welcome.
For the council representative, I guess it's me. I think I can do it. March 20th, that's Monday, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Still 7? No.
It's at 7.
7, but mm-hmm. You guys have something going on.
We have something before, but it's
okay.
Still 7.
Yeah, okay. Looking around the room, everybody's nodding agreeably. I will adjourn this meeting. Thank you very much. Thank you for everybody's patience. Thank you, Josh.